ASRock, they've been releasing their Deskmini series for quite a few years now. And this one right here, the X300 STX, represents something a little bit special. And not because it's got the RGB accessory that gives it a bit more bling, but because it supports 4000 series desktop APUs. And you may be wondering, Brian, 4000 desktop APUs, you can't buy them. They're for business only. And that's what I thought at first. And I asked around everywhere in Australia, asked around retailers and AMD directly, and they said, we can't get you one of these APUs in Australia. And then I went back to ASRock. I said, ASRock, you sent me one of these things out and you said it supports the new Ren/Nor APUs. And they said, yeah, we can't get you one. And I'm like, where can I get one of these APUs from? So I jumped on to AliExpress and lo and behold, readily available. You can just buy them, pop them in the cart, away you go. So I got myself a 4650G and popped it in this thing, didn't need to update any BIOSes, and then I got two SODIMM sticks of 8 GB of DDR4 memory. Now, weighing in, and this is fully packed with the cooler APU memory and M.2 installed at 1.26 kilograms, plus the adapter weighs in at 0.63 kilograms or 630 grams. It also has a very small footprint being 155 mil by 155 by 80. So this thing is just one of those portable little pieces of hardware that you can literally carry around anywhere with you. And you see here with the size of my hand's actually bigger than this whole unit. Now, the best thing about putting the 4650G inside is that you've got a decently powered APU. Not only do you get 6 cores, 12 threads of Zen 2 IPC, these things clock up to 4.3 gigahertz on all those 6 cores and 12 threads. For SODIMM memory, we got some of the cheapest stuff just locally here for $89 for the set, which would be like $60 for 16 gigabytes. This was 2666 megahertz CL19. Since SODIMM is generally not going to be as good, at least especially in value for money terms, as the desktop variants, but we managed to get this stuff still to 3200 megahertz at CL19. The 4650G's IMC will also do a decent job of handling the SODIMM architecture. Now, they had to go with SODIMM memory on this small form factor due to it, of course, being so small and needing every piece of room on this motherboard to make use of it, where the actual STX form factor is smaller than that of ITX. Now, in the box, you do get included a little cooler, but we decided, since we're using a 6-core 12 thread and the APU, we decided to use a Wraith Stealth. When, if you want to put the Wraith Stealth in the Deskmini series, you generally have to just take the plastic shroud off the top, and that'll allow you to then use the Wraith Stealth cooler, which does weigh in about 30% more, coming over 240 grams versus the included cooler, which is roughly around 160 grams off the top of my head. But do keep in mind, to mount the Wraith Stealth, you will have to bend the little end tabs in a little bit to mount this cooler initially, but after that, it works absolutely fine. Now, there is three M.2 mounting spots, an M.2 Wi-Fi at the front, and then above that, an Ultra M.2, meaning it'll support the SATA and also NVMe solutions. Then on the rear, you also get another M.2 slot, as well as two SATA ports, which they do come included in the box with the SATA and power adapters running off the motherboard directly. So you don't need a separate power cable to mount, say, a small 2.5 inch SSD off this motherboard. And that's because, well, there isn't a power supply in the actual case itself. What about the performance? And this is where I was pleasantly surprised. And I'm gonna say pleasantly surprised because we're gonna be testing this in an upcoming video, the 4650G versus the desktop X570 motherboard with much higher speed memory, to see how much performance we're losing. And I will pull up some 1050 Ti numbers for you guys, just as an alternative if you wanna go, say, get a Ryzen 5 3600 and a dedicated GPU, and it will perform better. There's no mistaking that. But one thing that dedicated solution cannot do is match the small footprint of the X300 right here. Starting off with Dota 2, where at 1080p on full res scale, low settings, we managed to squeeze 121 average FPS. And I did uncap this game from the default 120 FPS. So I was kind of like left scratching my head here because I was like, is this game capped? And then we uncapped it and it was still roughly around this FPS. And that was scoring 75 and also 63 on the 1% and 0.1% lows, making it a very, and I mean very, enjoyable experience on this little box right here. So if you're one of those people who think the human eye can't see more than 30 FPS, this is gonna be absolutely perfect for you as well with Dota 2. Moving over to CSGO, This is where we had about 100 FPS. I couldn't really measure this properly because for some reason it was blocking out River Tuner. So I actually couldn't get an accurate benchmark. But for what it's worth, low settings at 1080p, full res scale, was playing very well for CSGO. Then when I turned it on to high settings, it was starting to stutter, and the stuttering was very noticeable. Though moving on to Fortnite, we got a playable 54 average FPS at 1080p, full res scale, with competitive settings. That's the lowest settings and then the epic view distance, 37 and 20 on the 1% and 0.1% lows, which I was kind of surprised. The 1% and 0.1% lows weren't really like stuttering hardcore, which I kind of thought it may have with that so dim memory. But the last game definitely did present some challenges here. That was Warzone, where we did get a 72 average FPS at 720p. And this is where the 1% 0.1% lows were really bad. This game is very demanding. Warzone is extremely demanding. Even the 1050 Ti numbers, that can't play 1080p. That was playing 720p as well with 77 average FPS. But the problem with Warzone on the APU side of things was it just wasn't playing properly. There was textures not loading at all. I couldn't see properly. It wasn't a enjoyable experience. I mean, sure, if you just wanted to play with your mates and maybe be a bit of a support and just follow them around and get a few pops off, that might be what you can do with this. But I will be testing that again against the desktop variant to see if that problem is alleviated with higher speed memory. And the gaming numbers aside, what about the power consumption? This is probably one of the best parts of this little unit right here. When we're playing CSGO, for example, we're only juicing 70 watts from the wall. That was total system power consumption. So this little unit right here will definitely provide a playable experience on those easy to play games whilst giving you extremely low power consumption. Now, the max power consumption that we saw was during a Cinebench run where we just continually looped it. We got up to around 124 watts from the wall, and that produced the maximum temperature loading in 26 degree ambience at 82 degrees, and we measured roughly 42 decibels. So the noise is absolutely fine considering it's the stock included cooler, and the temperatures are still well under control. And now the last thing to go over with this unit is the productivity aspect. And that is in Cinebench. If we pull up the Cinebench numbers, 3,517 points, 413 on the single core. So you will be able to do, especially with 16 gigabytes of RAM, and say you're putting in an M.2, even if it's a SATA M.2, 1080p video editing will be absolutely fine on this little unit right here. The included APU is perfect for doing that 1080p editing, whether it's on DaVinci Resolve or Adobe Premiere Pro, but this thing's suited for that. And so if you want something that's portable, very minimalistic setup, this is going to provide that, but still have that little bit of power ready to do that light productivity. However, there is one compromise to the Deskmini, in my opinion, and that is the input and output. We've only got three USB ports in terms of type A, and then we've got one USB type C. You also do get a 1 gigabit per second Ethernet port on board, and there is options for expandability on the side here if you get the accessories, which can add another two USB ports, which I do recommend if you are going to use this for some sort of productivity. Now, in terms of the RGB that you see here, that's also another accessory, but the base cost of this unit is 170 USD. So that's for the motherboard, the case, and also the power brick, which is actually very, very value orientated considering what you get in this little package and considering the R&D that ASRock had to put into this thing to get it made. And all the testing is done. It's finished. We'll just blow that off. Could probably almost blow this thing off because it's that small and light. But it's conclusion time. Who is this unit for? Well, the answer is obvious. It's for someone who wants a portable little Zen 2 6-core 12-threaded monster that's not going to cost you much at all. And in fact, all you have to do to set this thing up, and this is another thing, the ease of building this thing is really good. You just get this unit here, the bare bones, whack in two sticks of sodium memory, make sure it's two sticks for dual channel, get an APU, get the cooler on, put your M.2 in, and you've got yourself a fully functioning PC. I think in total it was 9 screws to put this thing together, and it took 5 minutes. That's how easy it is. And the BIOS is already up to date, even with the 4000 series desktop APUs, which you can get them off AliExpress. And in total, the whole build cost is going to be, I think we spent under 500 to get a really contemporary, modern, small unit. Now, on the back, you can also mount this to a monitor, the back of a monitor if it's got a VESA mount. But the bottom line is I would recommend this to all types of PC users, starting from first time builders all the way up to people who have been building for years and years and they want something that's really quiet. I mean, I'll put my mic right up to this thing. And that's how quiet it is on idle. It's whisper quiet. It's going to be an absolute breeze of a unit if you're looking for something. Small form factor with the 6 cores, 12 threads. Or you can get the Ryzen, I think it's the Ryzen 7 4750G as well. That's another option. I just thought the 6 core 12 play was the best value out of the desktop APUs in the 4000 series. And with all that aside, I hope you guys enjoyed today's video of the X300 Desk Mini from ASRock. If you did, then be sure to hit that like button for us. And also let us know in the comment section below, are you looking forward to the next video when we compare this on the X570 motherboard? Love reading those thoughts and opinions as always, just like this question of the day here, which comes from 708914. And they ask, when are you going back to Japan next? And here's the thing about Japan. I've actually been longing to go back there. It is, in part of me in the back of my head wants to go back to Japan and have a fun time there. Like it's really missed, sorely missed. And you guys love the parts hunts that partake over in Japan. And I can't wait to get back there. So basically the answer to that question directly is as soon as I can get a flight there, I will. And then there'll be the content that'll follow and I'll get to see my lovely little son again, which I can't wait. Anyway, I'll catch you guys in another tech video very soon. If you stayed this far and you're enjoying the content, then I'll catch you in the next tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.